Hello, I'm Wendy. Today I'm painting watercolour meadows. It's a step-by-step tutorial for beginners. It's mid-July and I'm still enjoying my walks in the lovely meadows around my home. I wanted to do some more painting of them. I took some photographs, as you can see here, and what I've done is I've taken bits from each one of them and put them into a painting in a short tutorial. As you'll see shortly, I painted more than one of these. I did some practice runs, if you like, and really enjoyed trying out a few different compositions. So if you are going to follow this tutorial step by step, then please don't expect to copy it exactly as I've done, because if I copied mine, I wouldn't be able to do it the same again. I'm hoping by watching and possibly following along with me on this painting, then you'll learn some tips and techniques and hopefully learn how to simplify paintings, because that's a major problem, isn't it? You look at big views and it's very difficult to know how to simplify it down. I think I've managed to do that in this painting. So as I say, I hope you enjoy it and I hope you pick up some techniques to help you in your painting and taking your paintings forward. So this is the painting that I've filmed that I'll be demonstrating in this tutorial. I'll be going through the different steps and how to build it up from the background to the foreground. I'm showing you the next one. This was, I rather like this one actually. It's got lots of energy in it, and this was the first one I did that I didn't record. It was a bigger one. I cropped it down as well because I thought that composition worked better. And this is yet another one, and there was a lot more of the flowers in this one, which I quite like, but it was much more complicated, and the filming of this, it was a much longer and more complicated video. I may well try and get a short video out of this for YouTube, just showing particular points of the painting and its progression. I've not been using as much green in these paintings as I've used in the past. I've been trying to get some more muted colours and more of the sort of the light oranges and the browns that are in the meadows. I won't be showing you actual colour mixing on my palette during this video, but I have put together a colour sheet which you will see at the end of the video and which is downloadable, and it will show you some of the colour mixes that I've been using. I started off doing a little bit of masking out with a couple of brushes. I had some sort of clover shapes there, so I masked a few of those out and some other little shapes that would sort of stand for knapweed, so I could paint those in a sort of purpley colour. The brushes I'm using are just a little old one and an old rigger, which is not bent by design. It was just the way I unfortunately left it in the washing up liquid that I used to wash the brush, but it did the job. If you want to know more about applying masking fluid, then do follow the link that I've got in the description box below the video. As you can see, I did some very thin lines using the masking fluid for the grasses that were growing up and through the sky area. For the sky, I started off using a very, very dilute wash of raw sienna. It was almost dirty water because I wanted to keep it very light. And then using Payne's Grey with possibly a little bit of blue. You could use a little bit of red if you wanted it more on the purple side. Then I suggested some clouds in the sky. I didn't want a bright blue sunny day. I sort of wanted to get something a little bit more atmospheric, if you like, a bit cloudier, a bit more grey. And as you can see, it's working wet into wet. I'm keeping everything wet. You can play around with it a fair amount of time, as long as the paint is kept wet. As soon as it starts drying, then you're going to have awful things like runbacks, and you'll get the runbacks particularly if you put a very wet brush stroke on top of some paint that's drying. So try and always add more concentrated paint onto the paint that's underneath when you're doing these wet into wet washes. So while the sky was drying, I started on the meadow itself, and again I worked wet into wet for this time just for the initial stages, and you'll see later on in the video that I let this wet into wet wash dry and I painted some different leaf shapes, some wet onto dry on top of it. I wanted to keep it very pale, So again, I'm using raw sienna, possibly with a touch of a yellow in the background to keep it nice and light and bright in the background, and to sort of throw that area back in front of the browns that were going on in the foreground. I'm using burnt sienna, ultramarine to darken that in the foreground mainly, and I did introduce some green. As I said, I didn't want a lot of green in here, but I did introduce a subdued sort of green that I mixed from ultramarine and burnt sienna. And I wanted to try and keep the some different tones, lights and darks in this foreground, and maybe some different shapes. So I'm trying to do that with some darker tones and letting the brush sort of jump around a bit and do a few leaf strokes and or shapes that would suggest leaves and little bits of undergrowth there. I put in the distant trees when the sky was totally dry. These could have been work wet into wet, but I rather like the effect of using some dry brushwork on the trees in the distance. And the colours I'm using here are ultramarine with a bit of raw sienna, and I'm varying the green there with some darker areas and some lighter areas. Again, if you're interested in using dry brushwork, then I will put a link in the description box to at least one video that I've done talking about using dry brushwork. As you can see, I'm using the brush on its side. There's not an awful lot of paint on the brush. Now this brush, you can see, is a really old brush. I do have some new brushes, but this is a favourite brush of mine, and you can see that it's taped up to keep it together. But I do like this brush for doing this sort of work, so don't feel you've always got to have brand new brushes to work with. All your brushes have got a purpose. You can see now that the foreground is dry, and I'm working with a nicer brush on the foreground area, and I'm putting some sort of random shapes in there to stand for the leaves and that undergrowth there in the meadow. Now the shapes you make here is going to depend on your brush that you use and on your painting style. You could be a little bit more specific, put some more descriptive strokes in there, but I just like to dot around, as you've seen in my other videos, and keep everything very loose and quite intuitive. But what I'm doing here is I'm again varying the tones, so I've got some darker tones going in there and some lighter tones, and trying to put a few different colours in there, keeping it warm. Now I do overwork paintings and I do get too fussy, so I was really concentrating here to keep some of that background showing through, and hopefully I didn't overwork it too much. It's very easy when you're painting areas like this particularly to keep everything the same tone. Now if you do that, then the area is going to look very flat, it's going to have no depth to it. And just by having lights against darks in this area, then you are suggesting some depth and some tone into there. So do try and be thinking about that when you're painting. I'm thinking about that all the time when I'm doing this. I'm thinking about spacing, I'm thinking about the colours, I'm thinking about the tones that I'm putting down there. And you can see here at when I'm finishing this area that I'm doing some very watery marks on there, which again is giving some depth to this foreground. Now the next little bit of the demonstration I've speeded up because it is very repetitive. I'm really quite fond of this. I think it's dock that's growing in the meadow. It could be sorrel. And if anybody knows, you could let me know in the comments. But I really like it. I like the colours and I like the shapes of it. And you can introduce some quite nice darks into your paintings using this flower as your subject. Colour-wise, I think it does vary depending on the light that's on it. I've got some photographs of it looking very red and also looking quite brown. I mean, almost pure burnt sienna with light red in there. In this case, I did use some burnt sienna, some light red, but I introduced some blue to it in places as well to try and vary the colour and to vary the tones of it. And I'm using the rigger brush again very quickly. I did paint this very quickly. This is only twice the speed, so you can see it was pretty quick. I mean, that's how I do like to paint. I don't like to labour things and have things take a long time. I'm quite impatient with my painting, a bit too much sometimes, I think. But we all work in our own way. And I quite enjoyed doing these and dotting around and keeping some areas a little bit blocked in and changing the tones, as you can see. I haven't rubbed the masking fluid off yet at this stage, but I put on some grasses, again with a subdued green, and I'm using the rigger brush again. I didn't want to overdo this, but I did feel it needed some shapes going over that right hand side there that is looking rather empty, so a few there. And also I dotted around a little bit with some greens in places to suggest the seed heads on the grasses as well, so it gives it a little bit of life and a little bit of movement maybe in there, makes it a little bit more interesting. Now here I've removed the masking fluid, and as usual there might be a little bit of tidying up to do on some of the ugly shapes that you can get or with the masking fluid. And there weren't many on this, there's just one or two areas that I wanted to patch up. And then I put on a few individual grasses, and also with a very light colour I blocked in or coloured in the shapes of the that were left by the masking fluid that were very white, as I felt those were a little bit too distracting. I added back a little bit of light actually where the seed heads were, which suggested them sort of catching the light, and I'd done that in a previous one and I quite liked the effect. The clover shapes I painted in with raw sienna, and a little bit later defined them with a darker brown. And the knapweed, you want to use one of your purples to colour those in. I think that colour works quite nicely against the brown. Looking at it now, I did go in and I did put a little bit darker colour in there in the later stages. I felt it was a little bit pale. And then it's just really, not fiddling, but fine-tuning a few things. Having a look at the picture, seeing where you can put some extra darks. I mean, maybe around those knapweed flowers, just to set them off a little bit, you could put a little bit of dark, as I did. As I said, I put a little bit more on the clover shapes. And again, tried not to overwork the picture, which is very easily done at this stage. And I did darken the dock a little bit. I felt it just needed a few more darks at the top there. So this was the final painting of the demonstration. So particularly if you're a beginner out there and you're wondering how to tackle some of these complicated scenes, then remember you've not got to paint everything that's in front of you, and you can pick and choose what you want to paint from your photographs. Here are some colour swatches of the palette that I was using, and I hope you find this useful. You can download this from a link in the description box. I have been using Winsor and Newton Cotman colours throughout the video. Do subscribe to my channel if you haven't done so already, if you don't want to miss future content. As always, bye for now and happy painting.